And when Young takes a timeout, unless his partner initiates, and that's what I was saying earlier, is that I would like to see Barrientos initiate the conversation. Again, just to stay positive, just to try to keep each other pumped up.
That was your first timeout.
Whereas on the other side, Cassidy's very quick to chat with Gabriel, give him some feedback, give him some motivation.
Time is in. 6-6-2.
Wow, that's so tough. Because, I mean,
that's the downside of the Ernie. When you kind of fall in love with doing it, sometimes you do it at the wrong time, which is kind of.
Well, also, you know, Cassidy didn't see him going.
Right.
So that's the thing, too. You got to talk with your partner. You got to know if one is going to Ernie a lot or attempt it, you got to slide over and cover.
And it's a very tough cover for Cassidy because of where DJ Young is.
Yep.
Because the ball's not on the corner of the kitchen. It's right in the middle, so it just makes it a really tough cover. Ooh, that's a faith shot. Messing with the moneymaker.
6-7-2.
Nice hands there from Cassidy.
7-7-2.
I mean, that's what I love, too. I mean, Cassidy, no matter what, he's in good spirits. He's
going to be fun to watch, yeah, whether he's winning or losing.
Watch it!
Ooh. The wind held that up.
Oh, yeah. Good effort.
That's a reach by Young.
Yeah, Young's so good at this little baby.
A little drop shot, and he's ready for the next one. Yeah, uses his length right there.
And I think Young especially is kind of feeling the end is near, so he's going to ramp it up here.
Yep.
He's going to get more involved. He's going to get over on
aggressive.
Mario's side. Wow, that was the first time we've really heard Young and Barrientos yell here. Nice hands from Mario.
Time is called by the receiving team at 9-7.
We have a
one
timeout here from Cassidy and Tardio as Young and Barrientos just 2 points away from finishing this and heading to the winner bracket final.
Yeah, and we saw Tardio looking for that Ernie, and I would have liked to see him. Okay, the Ernie wasn't there. I would have liked to see him come back much quicker. He kind of came back onto the court a little slow, and so that middle was open for Barrientos, which he might have hit a winner there anyway, but I would like to see Tardio come back. And now they know he's looking for that Ernie, so they're not going to give him a lot of balls to the corner of the kitchen on that side. So I think Tardio needs to settle down a little bit, not keep looking for that Ernie constantly, and just play it a little more straight up.
15 seconds.
Until he knows for sure, because he's looking for it, in my opinion, way too much right now.
Yeah. Time is in. 9-7-1.
Unfortunate.
That's really tough.
Match point. First match point here for Young and Barrientos.
10-7-1.
There's the ball.
That's what I had to pickleball sign.
That's what I mentioned earlier, that I thought he might go speed up straight ahead, which he tried it, but. Got inside out here.
There. And again, that speed up that Young tried the previous rally, that's the only downside to DJ is because he is match point. He wants to finish it, and he wants to do it flashy, and he wants to do it, you know, in a big way. And I think sometimes that can make you push something that's not there. Nice cover from Tardio.
Yeah, great job. All right, putting a little pressure here. See if they can get to within one. And they do.
9-10-1.
Cassidy thought they might, both might maybe both hit the.
I saw that you both, it looked like you both hit the ball. The one prior to the winner.
Interesting. I mean, we can't really tell, but he thinks both of them maybe hit this shot in the middle. No, it looks like DJ missed it. I mean, Mario's the one that hit it, not DJ.
Yeah, I was going to ask both of them.
Yeah, DJ's saying he didn't hit it.
Here we go, gentlemen.
Yep, I think he missed it. I mean, he certainly tried to hit it, but. So Cassidy feels pretty sure that he thought the ball hit both paddles, and it's hard to tell from the replay. From the replay,
it
feels like he missed it, but and then.
And I don't.
Sometimes it's a sound. Sometimes it's you hear a little tip, and then but it's just too hard. No one's going to be able to call that.
But they're still 1 point away from tying this up.
Yep.
Yeah, shake that off and just stay in it.
See. Gosh, I know Cassidy gets a lot of those balls back, but I think percentages.
Yes,
to me, you want to just slide back, give yourself a better chance.
Sometimes he just locks himself into something that doesn't ultimately help in the long run.
Oh!
All right, fourth match point opportunity here for Young and Barrientos. Can Cassidy and Tardio hold him one more time? Cassidy immediately says, oh, so stupid, as he
He got impatient with that. I think he should have stayed on Barrientos, but.
Wow, great match. So DJ Young, Mario Barrientos come out on top and head to the winner bracket final. We'll see who they face in our second semifinal coming up next. I'll head to the Franklin studio and then back into the action here at the SoCal Classic right after that. Welcome to the Franklin Studio, everyone. Lauren McLaughlin here with Mario Barrientos and DJ Young. Bit of a battle here in the semifinals. That first game, first of all, did you feel like one of the sides played better than the other?
Yeah, I like playing this side better because it's against the wind. The other one with the wind is a little tougher to make some drops and everything, but still pulled it out no matter what, so it doesn't matter.
So you guys have played together a few times. You guys took silver in Cincinnati together. What is sort of your strategy as a partnership in the way you both play that you think will make you successful going into tournaments?
I think we just play to our strengths. Like DJ is really good in his side, and that's when he feels comfortable. And I play really good in the other side. And we just, we're not like prideful in the sense that this is your ball, this is my ball. We both know that he's going to take some balls that are closer to me and I might take other ones, but just we complement each other good in that sense, and I think that gives us an advantage.
So there were a few timeouts during that match that you guys were on opposite sides of the court. You guys didn't talk at all. Is that just you guys know what you'd already talked about and what you need to adjust, or is it just why no talking?
Well, Mario and I usually talk between points anyway, so we kind of know what we have to do and what we don't have to do. So like that last time out after the drop, I think we both know why I called it, and there's no need to talk about it. Like, you know, it happened. Let's take a breather and just come back and, you know, fuck some shit up.
Well, that can't be bleeped out, but thank you so much for that. You kind of say that pickleball is still kind of a hobby. You have young kids, yeah. You're in school still. So when you're able to come out here on tournaments, do you feel like it's a little tougher since you're not on the tournament circuit as much as other people?
Yeah, the especially the physical fitness kills me because I don't have time to work out or anything. I just play and drill. You know, it's not like I go to the gym or anything. So that I can't lose weight. Yeah, so I'm a little with a disadvantage in that sense. But besides that, I think I'm good. I definitely need to work more, you know, to get better. But as you said, it's like my side thing still. And hopefully, I mean, the good thing is I have DJ, so he's carrying me. He's carrying my overweight with him.
It's not a problem. It's not a problem. You guys are doing very well so far.
I like him thick.
This is going off the rails. All right, you're into the winter bracket final. Congrats, guys. We'll
Thank
see
you.
Who you're playing next after we finish this semifinal. Don't go anywhere. More action here at the SoCal Classic right after this. sunny SoCal at the APP SoCal Classic. We are here at Bobby Riggs Tennis and Racket Center in Encinitas, California, just north of San Diego. And it is day two of our live streaming coverage here with our men's and women's doubles brackets. We have our second semifinal match up right now here for our men. J.W. Johnson and Dylan Frazier will take on Chuck Taylor and Rafa Hewitt. Marcia Frezzo will be our USA Pickleball Certified referee. And I am Lauren McLaughlin along with Daniel Roditti here in the booth courtside. As I mentioned before, Chuck Taylor, it was just his birthday on Thursday, turned 39 years old. He is out of Lehi, Utah. Went to Brigham Young University for school, and he is an actuary. Partner Rafa Hewitt, originally from Idaho, where his family had a cattle ranch and now winery. Currently in Auburn, Alabama, though. He was on the winning team of BLQK at MLP's first 2022 event. They are on the far side. Here in game one, they take on the youngsters of J.W. Johnson in the blue, 19 years old, Delray Beach, Florida area, and Dylan Frazier, 20 years old, out of Ashland, Missouri. Dylan Frazier took gold yesterday with J.W. Johnson's sister, Georgia Johnson, defeating J.W. Johnson and Lee Whitwell, who took silver. Too high there from J.W. Johnson.
Great exchange, great hands by Hewitt and Taylor. Hewitt says, I'm taking that.
Hewitt's another very fiery, loud vocal player who's generally very entertaining to watch. Ooh, Dylan Frazier's gonna
nice little
quiet them down real quick with that.
Speed up at the right hip.
0-0-2.
Rafa Hewitt, also a lefty, so we're going to see him almost exclusively on that right side as well, but loves a two-handed backhand, as you saw just there. Johnson and Frazier, the number one seeded team here today. They had a bye their first round, then took down Nick Pedersen and Porter Barr. Then defeating Wyatt Stone and Federico Staxrud to get here to the semi. Have not dropped a game yet.
Wow.
Chuck Taylor and Rafa Hewitt also had to buy their first round. They're the number four seed, and they defeated Brian Thiem and Paul Warner. And then Shelton Jean-Baptiste and Will Gardner in their quarterfinal matchup. That went to three games. And winner of this match will face DJ Young and Mario Barrientos in the winner bracket final.
And I think the losing team will take on Arnold and Patrickin.
All right.
So that'll be fun.
Also a great
on the
match.
Other, yeah, on the other back draw.
Wow. Nice pickup from Johnson on the ATP from Hewitt. That was interesting because Taylor had that, and then it's almost like he.
Yeah, he tried to roll it too much, tried to put too much spin. He didn't need to. They were both back. He could have just pushed that ball deep at them. And pressure going again to that Taylor forehand, just a little late on it. And then the other semi-final on the back draw will be Cassidy and Tardio taking on Stone and Stocksrud.
Oh, another great match.
Hewitt almost gets that ball.
2-4-2.
Hewitt and Chuck Taylor, both big family men. Hewitt has three little ones. I believe Chuck has four. Someone correct me if I'm wrong.
We got Father's Day tomorrow, so it's a big weekend for Taylor with his birthday and Father's Day.
And both of them got real loud on that last exchange. It would certainly, I think, be an upset if Hewitt and Frazier were, excuse me, Hewitt and Taylor were able to take down Johnson and Frazier here.
Well, we see a little backhand cut serve there from Hewitt just to mix it up. And does it again since it worked.
Yeah, he's got a couple of funky serve options.
Frazier's been speeding up quite a bit at Taylor. Let's see if he continues with that. Oh, get the fortunate leg court there for Hewitt. Take the lead.
Yeah, Hewitt's another one of those players you can absolutely put in the category of emotional, fiery, you know, plays great when he's up, can get a little down sometimes. Oh, that stuck to the tape and just Velcro rolled across that net. So yeah, when Hewitt, and again, Chuck Taylor is absolutely going to feed off of Hewitt's energy.
Right.
It's impossible not to. Nice leave. Hewitt, he's never going to, if he has an option to speed it up or slow it down, he's going speed every
he's
time.
He's going to speed it up. There's a cut serve again.
No.
number two.
Yeah, oh, see that again.
Yep.
Frazier's gone to that inside hip, that right hip of Taylor three times that I can remember already.
4-6-1.
But he's also gone a couple times up the line, so he's got to be ready.
Yep.
Yeah, just too high. Special with Hewitt with his forehand there. That ball's gonna go long.
Come on, baby. Come on. 5-6-2.
Wind picking up a little bit.
Yeah, wind's gonna be behind the back of Johnson and Frazier into the face of Hewitt and Taylor, so. DJ Young mentioning in his interview after the last match he preferred going into the wind. As a player, Daniel, are you the same? Would you rather go into the wind or with the wind?
Yeah, so I'd like to speed things up too, and I like to drive. And so when you're going against the wind, you don't have to worry about hitting too many out balls. And so I, you know, probably depends, but I would say probably in general I do prefer going against the wind a little bit. You feel like you can really hit out on your serve and you don't have to worry about it going long. Same with the return. Like you really put some pace on it and not have to worry about it sailing. So
looks like we're going to have a timeout here, I believe, offensively for Frazier and Johnson. As they are trailing two, they will have the serve when they come back in from this timeout, though. Both teams right near each other. Talking a little bit. There's Porter Barr, Julian Arnold, courtside. A lot of the pros watching their peers playing.
Yeah, Arnold keeping a close eye on this as he's going to play the losing team. That would be another fun team to get on center court if they get far enough. Patrick Kinn obviously being a young 16-year-old who's been doing so well. And of course,
yeah,
fiery Arnold with him. Even with the win.
6-7-2.
Watch the speed up.
Hewitt maintain a slim 1-point lead.
Yeah.
A little miscommunication about who was possibly going to attempt to get that. But great shot nonetheless. If you're Johnson and Frazier, do you think they need to be targeting Taylor or Hewitt? Or is it just kind of...
You know, I think you got to... more play kind of what they're giving you, but Frazier's having some success speeding up to Taylor. I anticipate he's going to keep doing that. He's going to mix it up, kind of try to throw some dinks in there and then speed it up.
Yeah!
Hewitt, very vocal. I've already seen some chest bumps, some body bumps between himself and Taylor.
That's a great return there. Cut backhand serve.
For Hewitt and Taylor, do you think there's something about the fact that they know this is the favored team to win today that kind of fuels them a little bit more?
Oh, for sure. I mean, there's an element of, I think we talked about it yesterday with one of the matchups, is you're playing with house money, right? You're playing against mm-hmm. a favorite team. You have nothing to lose, so no reason to be nervous. And you're going to get pumped up. You're going to try to get yourself psyched up, believing that you can take them down. There it is.
That
speed up there from Frazier. And Taylor having to guess because he's done it a couple times to his right hip. He's done it mm-hmm. up the line, and now he goes middle.
Yep.
It just makes it that much tougher to read.
Again, they let it drop because they have the wind into their face. They're hoping the wind is sailing these shots a little bit longer.
Right.
It's
obvious that they've talked about that hey, we got to let some balls go because of the wind, but that one was just too low, stays in, had enough spin to come down.
Yep, so Frazier and Johnson, 2 points away from getting the job done here in game one of the second semifinal with a spot in the winner bracket final on the line. And I think, as we mentioned, I think Rafa Hewitt is a player that he almost likes to be the underdog.
Yeah.
He likes to be the person that has something to prove, something to show for it, that he can hang with people that maybe the outside looking in wouldn't think he should be able to win. And they've done a fantastic job here in game one. Certainly kept it close, very competitive. Had the lead at points.
Yeah, just too much there from Johnson.
Yeah, that was three in a row of the exact same spot. Hewitt was able to get the first two, but third one just a little too much. 10-7-2. Game point.
That's a great drop. 8-10-1. Yeah, just a little miscommunication there. Rafa calling Chuck Taylor off, but wasn't able to do enough of it. It was actually from Hewitt's serve.
Yep. Had so much spin on it that after Johnson returns it, it still has that spin and just
kind of
really hurt Taylor there.
That's long, tough.
Almost were able to tie it up, but Johnson and Frazier hold on. Still not dropping a game, but Taylor and Hewitt definitely made them work for it here in game one. Let's see what happens in game two. We'll take a short break into the action right after this. The APP SoCal Classic is brought to you by Pickleball Central, the pickleball superstore catering from beginners to pros. Yola, for the champion in you. SunMed, the official CBD sponsor of the APP. And Chevile, modern pickleball apparel that reminds people to be civil and play nicely. Welcome back here to game number two in our second semifinal here in men's pro doubles at the APP SoCal Classic. Lauren McLaughlin and Daniel Roditti, a little out of breath. We were throwing towels into the crowd.
Yeah.
Daniel threw one over the bathroom building.
Yep.
Into the neighboring business. So
someone's got a
take
souvenir.
It down a notch. Take it down a notch.
Someone's got a souvenir of a brand new towel. It's going to be a pleasant surprise when they
Beach Boy towels
drive into their driveway.
J.W. Johnson, Dylan Frazier on the far end here for game two. Ooh, nice hands from Frazier.
Yeah.
Taking on Rafa Hewitt in the gray. Chuck Taylor in the blue on the near end. If you're Taylor and Hewitt, what did you talk about in game one that needed to happen here in game two after this?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're playing well. They're, mm-hmm. I mean, you don't go 11-9 against JW and Dylan if you're not playing well. So they need to keep doing what they were doing.
The wind's going to be different now for both teams to adjust to.
Yeah. And I think Dylan asking Chuck if he saw it. He said he thought it was close, but he thought it was in.
Dylan Frazier, notorious for being very generous on line calls. Seen him play more out balls than I can probably count.
And so to your question, too, I think I would just, you know, if I'm Rafa, tell Chuck to be ready for the speed ups from Dylan straight ahead. There it is. That was a semi-speed up. It was kind of an off-speed ball, but he's doing that a lot. He's mixing it up, going up the line to Chuck's back end and then going inside, so Chuck's got to be ready for that. That's out. And maybe just slightly play off the line when Dylan's, especially a forehand, when Dylan's hitting a forehand, I would just maybe back up just a tad. There it is. Yeah, I mean, it's
nice spot.
I think you play off the line a little bit. Rafa's got to sit on that middle with his forehand, and then Chuck's just got to cover that line.
Yeah, and I think what we're seeing here in game two that wasn't happening in game one is we're seeing a lot more errors from Hewitt and Taylor.
Right.
Their execution is not nearly as crisp and clean as it was in game one, which is why the score was so close. I think game one really was a matter of just a couple execution things here or there. But Frazier and Johnson just fully in control here in game two. It seems like Hewitt and Taylor just a little knocked off their game.
Yeah, it's a little deflating when you're that close and then you get to within one, right? They had the little run when they were down 10-7. I think they get it to 10-9. And then you lose it on a miss return. It's just deflating because you're so close. But then you have to regroup. I know these guys are just going to play better. So you have to elevate your game as well. Yeah, and you see just not a lot of energy, which obviously is hard to have high energy when you're down 7-0. But
angle like there you're just Hewitt.
Yeah, Chuck trying to get the crowd fired up. But if I'm the crowd, like, hey, I'm feeding off of you. You get fired up, I'll get fired up. Oh, I'm gonna miss her.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. Like those kind of errors, you can't have that.
Right.
At this level in a semifinal against the number one seeded team.
Wow.
Well, too much heat
from Hewitt.
Things
not going their way right now. 7-0-1. But you're just looking for anything. If you're Hewitt and Taylor, any kind of Yeah.
And we saw yesterday, I mean, J.W. Johnson, I think, no surprise to anyone, he's an amazing, phenomenal player. But Dylan Frazier, great player, but yesterday we saw him play just lights out.
Yep.
So he's playing some absolutely fantastic pickleball, and the two of them together.
There's that speed up again, forehand side, mm-hmm. and I think they just have to sit on that ball and not worry about his dinks. They have to know he's just looking to speed up, give him the dinks, but be ready for the speed up. Yeah, just too many errors. It's just, we might, I'm surprised we didn't get a timeout there, but. 10-0-1.
Possible.
Yeah, that's it.
Pickle situation here for game number two. So, again, that's how quickly the tides turn here in pickleball, depending on the ends, how the wind's playing. A team just gets hot. So what was a very close, competitive game one here in the semifinal turned into anything but here in game two, a very quick and decisive win for J.W. Johnson and Dylan Frazier. So they go to face Mario Barrientos and DJ Young in our winner bracket final. I believe we have our women coming up next. So we will keep you guys posted as we have our matches coming up, but we should have our women's winner bracket final. But don't hold me to that 100%. I'll go check. But we're into the Franklin studio with Johnson and Frazier next, and then back for more action right after this.
So ready for next gen.
This is Next Gen Pickleball.
I'm so ready for the Next Gen Tour.
Super excited about Next Gen.
I can't wait for the APP Next Gen Tour.
I'm super excited for Next Gen.
If you like to dink, then Pickleball Magazine has what you're looking for. Our bi-monthly print publication will help you become a better player with instructional tips, drills, and articles from the top teaching pros in the sport. And you'll become a healthier, stronger player with psychological, nutritional, and wellness advice from experts in their fields. Finally, if it's product reviews or the latest news, we have that too. To learn more or to subscribe today, go to pickleballmagazine.com.
Welcome back to the Franklin Studio. Lauren McLaughlin here with Dylan Frazier and J.W. Johnson as they head to our winner bracket final. So let's first address, you guys faced off in the gold medal match last night. Dylan, you were able to come out on top. Did you have to have like a couples counseling session to make sure going into today was going to be smooth?
No, I think we were cool. J-Dub's got the best of me a lot, and so I kind of owed him one. So yeah. We were good.
Coming into today, you've played together many times. You know each other so well, good friends. That first game, Hewitt and Taylor kept it very competitive, made you guys work for it. What was the difference going into game two that made you guys just run away with that?
I made sure Dylan would get out of the way of some balls instead of just keep hitting them or getting hit by them. So luckily he did that a little bit. Of course, we still didn't get any earnings by him. But, we just worked it out. Slow it down a little bit and then just try to pick up on their patterns.
You're going to face DJ and Mario in the winter bracket final. You know DJ very well. Mario probably a little bit less, yep. But what's going to be the thought for you guys going into that matchup?
We're going to come in. We're going to want to play a consistent game, I think, and kind of move the ball around a lot, trust our hands, and don't come out tentative. Just kind of take it to them.
Anything else to add, Chatterbox?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll try to hit DJ. But hopefully not like last time, so he doesn't have to take another medical. So we'll find out.
Maybe you could, like, growl at him like he does. It'll be very intimidating.
Dylan's got the best of that. He can probably do that.
Dylan's got the growl.
I'll take care of it.
Great job, guys. We'll see you in that winner bracket final. Don't go anywhere. More pickleball action still to come here at the SoCal Classic.
For next gen.
This is Next Gen Pickleball.
I'm so ready for the Next Gen Tour.
Super excited about Next Gen.
I can't wait for the APP Next Gen Tour.
I'm super excited for Next Gen.
Welcome back, everyone. So, Byron Frezzo just doing our little player introductions for the crowd here at Bobby Riggs. Welcome to our women's winner bracket final here at the APP SoCal Classic. Oh, they're singing. Hang on. They tell you happy birthday, dear Lauren. Happy birthday to you. Woo! Didn't want to interrupt the birthday song.
Yeah.
Lauren McLaughlin and Daniel Roditti here courtside for the action. We, of course, have Lauren Stratman and Lee Whitwell taking on Anna Bright and Georgia Johnson. Anna Bright and Georgia Johnson played together in Anna's very first pro tournament ever, which was Punta Gorda, Florida earlier this year, which was her big giant breakout performance. They got gold together over Simone Jarjim and Corinne Carr.
Wow.
So no small feat. So they have had lots of success together as partners. I'm blanking now. They won gold in a recent tournament as well on the tour, and I'm trying to remember if it was St. Louis? I can't remember. Don't hold me to that. But they are very successful as partners. They both in the same area of Southeast Florida, around the Delray Beach area. So they get to play together a lot. Good friends, get to drill together. So let's see if they can keep that success going. They took out the Brasha sisters, Mary and Maggie, in their first match of the day, then defeated Michelle Esquivel and Regina Franco in the semis to get here, while Lee Whitwell and Lauren Stratman took out Daniel Toffin at a right in their first match of the day, and then defeated Paris Todd and Susanna Barr in two. So Lauren Stratman, as we mentioned, birthday girl today. She turns 28 years old, originally from Santa Barbara, California, now in Knoxville, Tennessee with her family. Lee Whitwell, 47 years old, originally from Bend, Oregon, now splits her time between the Villages in Florida and Austin, Texas, where she does a lot of work for MLP Duper Dreamland. Anna Bright, 24 years old, played D1 tennis at the University of California, Berkeley. She's graduated a year ago. Georgia Johnson, 15 years old, no college yet. So we'll keep you posted on maybe where she decides to go if she does. So Whitwell and Stratman are the number one seeded team here today, while Johnson and Bright the number four. Winner of this heads to the gold medal match. Loser will head to bronze.
Looks like Patrickin and Arnold are about to take on Taylor and Hewitt.
Yep, that's going to be on the court just behind championship court. So technically, you can kind of watch that match unfolding as well from our baseline cam view.
I think they're putting them over here.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I mean, you could still kind of see it.
Yeah, a little
up
corner,
in the left corner,
little corner
there.
View. 2-1-2. Oh, yeah.
Pam Graves is our USA Pickleball Certified referee for this match. One, two, one. Whitwell just leaving a little too high on this.
Yeah, I think she should have stayed on Bright. She had Bright. I mean, Bright playing great defense, but.
And when she went to switch it, she came under the ball and just lifted it up right for Georgia Johnson to put that away. Just trying to work Whitwell there.
Fist pump by Whitwell.
Yeah, she had to withstand a lot of heat there from Bright. I imagine Whitwell's going to be picked on a little bit during this match. Stuff you think Whitwell's a lefty, so that puts two forehands in the middle. So you think, if nothing else, they're both gonna kind of have that middle covered.
Yeah, but Whitwell looked like she looked like she was expecting the body shot, and she was covering the body.
Johnson, we saw it yesterday. Can get very aggressive. She likes the poach. She likes to get in there. I mean, Johnson came literally all the way over to take that. But again, that's kind of what we talked about yesterday. Once you engage yourself, stay engaged.
Right.
Your partner kind of hangs back, just kind of hoping to support.
Right.
But it's almost better for you to just keep going so that your partner doesn't get caught then thinking, I was supposed to get that ball. I didn't know because you were engaged.
Especially when you're kind of taking over the middle. Seeing some errors from Whitwell. We saw a little bit of that in the gold medal match yesterday in the mixed.
The wind has died down a little bit from earlier, but definitely still a breeze playing a factor here to an extent. From all four ladies getting involved in that rally, but ultimately Bright and Johnson able to come out on top.
2-8-2.
Oh.
Ooh, little body shot there.
Nice poach there from Whitwell, who also likes to get a little aggressive sometimes. Big step there with that left foot. Stratman trying to get a little something going here.
4-8-2.
Oh, net court.
Little net court.
Some unfortunate for Bright and Johnson, but it's exactly what Stratman Witt will need to kind of keep this rolling.
Yep.
He'll take it any way it comes.
Woodwell kind of reached with a backhand there, which was, I think she was set up for a backhand, reached across, probably should have just let that ball go to Stratman.
Yeah, I think Woodwell is, she sets up a lot for the block. She's kind of always looking for a block.
Yep.
And then it can be, so then you're set up constantly
right.
with that backhand.
And sometimes and you reach with it, yeah.
To pull it over to the other side. Oh, nice pickup from Woodwell.
Uh-oh.
Oh, right into
the mic.
The mic. I mean, I think she had it. She was a foot into the net, so she just angled it incorrectly. Yeah, really pinning them back.
Almost. Called out. Lee staring the line down. I thought it missed, but.
Oh, yeah, that's well out.
Yeah, it was out.
Timeout called by the receiving team. So we got a timeout here from Whitwell and Stratman. As Johnson and Bright 2 points away. And outside of, you know, cutting down the errors, are you seeing anything in Stratman and Whitwell that needs to be adjusted?
Yeah, no, I mean, you mentioned it. I mean, I think a lot of those points have been just, you know, mistakes that they don't normally make. A little just better communication on those middle balls, right, as to who's going to have that. Depending on where the ball's coming from, probably the angle will determine who's going to take that since they're both forehands. But you know, Bright and Johnson, they're just playing really well. And so sometimes you kind of have to weather the storm a little bit when someone's kind of hot. And you just have to hang in there until you get a chance to go on a run. Well, all over that. Yeah, see Bright going back. That's the time to Ernie.
I mean, yep, we saw it too. Mm-hmm. Wasn't quite as egregious as others. Oh, I heard
we get an Andiamo.
All right, yeah, you can see Julian Arnold, Hayden Patrick Quinn on the far end up in that left corner. Game point here for Brighton Johnson. Ooh. Oh. Ugh. Come on, pickups. Ooh.
So I watched a little bit of the Brasha sisters match against Georgia Johnson and Anna Bright, and Georgia had so many of those pickups, those balls low at her feet. She was getting everything back, mm-hmm. and we saw an example of that again.
Reach from Whitwell covering that line. G Johnson has a lot of success when she is playing against Whitwell on that cross court.
Yep.
I've seen it multiple times in other tournaments. She really just kind of works her on that cross court dink and tries to get that error. More opportunities for Johnson and Bright to take game one here in our winner bracket final.
10-6-1. Yeah, overreaching there. And maybe again, maybe the wind played a part. Maybe the wind held it up a little bit more than Johnson anticipated, forcing her to overreach.
I thought for sure that was going to be a side out after Bright left that up a little high, but good recover off that net cord and put it away. So Johnson and Bright hold on, taking game one 11-6. We'll switch ends, take a short break, and back into the action to see who's going to gold right after this. Welcome back for game number two here in our Women's Pro Doubles Winner Bracket Final here at the APP SoCal Classic, one of our Tier 2 events here on the APP Tour. Georgia Johnson and Anna Bright on the far end. Taking on Lee Whitwell and Lauren Stratman on the near end. As I mentioned, this is a Tier 2 event, so that means $50,000 or less prize pool. Usually at a smaller venue, more regional. And we really structure these Tier 2 events to be sort of specifically for letting those kind of pros that aren't necessarily in the top 10 to get a little more exposure, a little more experience, perhaps some better results. So not always all the top pros are at the Tier 2s, which right. is the point. You right. know, we have the elite level tournaments, which are higher than 50. We had the New York Open, $125,000 on the line was our last tournament. So love being able to see. We saw a lot of new faces yesterday, new partnerships.
Yeah.
And that is specifically what these Tier 2s are about. So very excited for that. here at Bobby Riggs.
Yeah, and this has always been a popular tournament. Just obviously the location. Who doesn't want to come to San Diego area here in beautiful Southern California?
Next weekend we head to El Segundo, just outside of Los Angeles, for the LA Open, another Tier 2 event. Super fun. A lot of times, especially in California, we see a lot of West Coast players that we don't see travel too far across the country to the other, you know, Florida tournaments and such. So very excited to see a lot of the West Coast players here when we're in California, which is always exciting. We, of course, have a packed crowd here at Bobby Riggs and up in our Chevrolet VIP balcony. Everyone's having a great time with that skybox view of the action here on Championship Court. You can see it there. Excellent camera work as always from Pickleball TV, run by Spencer Laurent and Mitch DeVoe, bringing you this production this weekend and next weekend at the LA Open. Yeah, Johnson and Bright just continuing to be dominant here.
They're on a roll right now.
Either good patience from Stratman, but Johnson's just there.
All over it, and Whitwell should have come over as Stratman was going for that ATP. I'm sure she realizes that. Oh, ITP.
Attempt of that one, into the net.
Bright's got a little interesting thing. She's serving. She likes to spin her paddle several times before contact.
Yep. It's funny to watch all the players. Everyone has a routine.
Every single
player has a routine. Even amateurs. They might not realize it, but you do. And we're not seeing a timeout from Stratman and Whitwell.
Yeah, I'm surprised.
We saw yesterday Whitwell and J.W. Johnson. They also didn't call a timeout, and that's kind of something they struggle with. And I'm not sure why that is.
Yeah, just too much right now from Johnson and Bright. They're on a roll. They're confident. You can see their body language.
And on the opposite side, I mean, Stratman and Whitwell, their body language is, it's almost like we're giving ourselves into the inevitable. And so I'd like to see a timeout, at least try and slow the momentum. Just try something, but we have a match point here for Anna Bright and Georgia Johnson. Nice pull there from Stratman.
And, I mean, you do have, this is winter bracket final, so you know, in the back of your mind, you're like, all right, we drop down to the bronze, and then we have a shot to come back.
I mean, both these teams on the podium no matter what.
Right.
I think both Stratman and Whitwell thought each other was taking that. So they just kind of look at each other. Very well see a repeat of this match in the gold medal match, depending how the bronze plays out and which team has come through the back draw.
Yeah, I see Barr and Todd taking on taking on Gaten Leach and Genie. I forget Genie's last name, excuse me. But
it's Arokima.
Yeah.
It's,
they just took down the Brashas to get to that point. Oh, well, I don't know if she was. I don't know if she was even established. Yeah! Well, that's it.
All right, so a very similar outcome to the men's match we just saw previously, where J.W. Johnson and Dylan Frazier were able to get an 11-0 win in that second game. But Anna Bright and Georgia Johnson head to gold, which seems to be what they like to do as a partnership. So not a bad thing. But Stratman and Whitwell head to bronze. We will take a short break. I'll head to the Franklin studio, and then we should have our men's winner bracket final coming up after that. Don't go anywhere. SoCal Classic continues right after this. Welcome back to the Franklin studio. Lauren McLaughlin here with Anna Bright and Georgia Johnson, who are once again heading to a gold medal match as partners. You guys, oh, excuse me, you're okay.
Apologies.
She's good. So you guys took gold in your first ever tournament that you guys played together. You took silver in St. Louis, but you're headed to gold again. What do you think works so well about you guys together?
I think we both are pretty heavy-handed and have quick hands, so when we're both firing, like, we have a lot of options. And Georgia has a lot of tricky shots, and I'm kind of developing that part of my game. And also, we're both really comfortable on both sides. We just do whatever's working, depending on the matchup.
Excellent. You're coming off a big gold medal win yesterday. Obviously, must have a lot of confidence coming in today. Sure. Do you think that has helped just kind of booster your energy coming in today?
Well, actually, I feel more tired because I played all day yesterday. But
that too, I guess.
Yes, I mean, I feel like I always play confident, especially with Anna. She really pumps me up, and I like our partnership. And like she said, we're both comfortable on either side, and I think that's really important when you are playing with a partner. So, yeah, super excited.
All right, well, congratulations, lady. Once again, headed to gold as a partner, so we're excited to see you in just a few matches in that. Go take a rest, grab a snack, and we will see you guys in gold. But coming up next, we have our men's winner bracket final, so do not go anywhere. SoCal Classic continues right after this.